Okay, so first of all, I just wanted to say thank you very much for the invitation. It's a real honor to speak here today. What I'm going to talk about today is the question of how we hear sounds in context, how our perception of sounds and brain mechanisms of sound perception are altered by the context in which a sound appears. But first, I want to start by kind of putting this talk in context by playing a little bit of music that will illustrate some of the principles I'm going to talk about today. All right, this is what I'm going to play for you is a bit of In C by a composer named Terry Riley. This piece was composed in 1964, and it's a significant piece because every performance of it is unique and of arbitrary length. And that's because the piece is composed of 53 phrases, which the musicians cycle through at their own rate. There's an underlying pulse of a high C that gives this piece its structure, and that the other movement in the piece is organized around. So this piece is also significant historically because it's considered the origin of the minimalist movement in 20th century music. And the composition and performance of this piece inspired other famous composers such as Philip Glass and Steve Reich. And it also inspired a late 20th century focus on the process of music production and perception. So I'm going to play you the beginning of this. Let's see how this goes. Sorry for the... This is the beginning of In C. Then I'll switch to a later point in the piece. Stop in just a minute for my computer too. Okay, so I'm going to use this piece as a way of illustrating some of the principles of how the brain responds to acoustic context. So to give you a bit of an overview of the whole talk, the key ideas that I want to get across in this talk is that hearing fundamentally depends on context, and that can be context at multiple time scales: the time scale of developmental experience, of behavioral significance, and of the local acoustic context. And then also, another important point is that cortical mechanisms seem to contribute fundamentally to this contextual sensitivity. All parts of the central auditory system are involved, but the cortex seems to be a driving force. So to give you a brief outline of the talk, first I'm going to talk a little bit more about what I mean by context. Next, I'll tell you the kind of big picture of why it is that hearing seems to depend on context. I'm going to give you a few examples of modulation, of both from music and from neuroscience, of how developmental context affects hearing. And this is examples from other labs. I understand there's been lectures in this series from Dan Sains and Christoph Schreiner. I think Dan Sains would have talked about developmental experience affecting central auditory processing. And Christoph Schreiner would have probably talked about the effects of behavioral context, behavioral training on auditory processing. So I'll give you a few examples from music and also from neuroscience for those. And then I'm going to spend most of the time talking about a case study, which is related to my own research on the impact of short-term acoustical context on central auditory processing. And here, I'm going to start by discussing the general problem of how we can even study the effects of acoustical context on cortical activity or thalamic activity. And then I'll go on to what we've discovered about how acoustical context affects central auditory processing. And then we'll conclude. Okay, so what is context? Context can mean any one of many different timescales. At the very longest timescale of years to months to days, we might mean how the developmental experience of a human being or an animal with sounds, what kinds of sounds they heard during development, we might mean that as developmental context. And it's been shown in decades of work that the experience an animal has during development with sounds and sound patterns, even when those sounds are not causing any kind of hearing damage, any kind of hearing loss, just the experience of sounds can shape the way the brain subsequently responds to sounds. On a shorter time scale of hours to minutes, or days even, the behavioral significance of a sound is well known to shape the way the auditory system responds to sound. And then finally, on the shortest time scale of the acoustical neighborhood, the immediate acoustical context in which a sound appears also has a major impact on the way the brain responds to that sound. So we're going to focus first on developmental context. As a kind of big picture summary, why do I say that hearing depends on context? Fundamentally, it's because the sound-evoked responses of central auditory neurons are modified by developmental experience. They are modulated by behavioral state and behavioral training, and they're shaped non-linearly by spectrotemporal conjunctions of sounds. And this is true especially, but not exclusively, in the cortex. So this is a diagram, the Netter diagram of the ascending auditory pathway. And you can see down here a zoomed in picture of the organ of Corti in the cochlea of the inner ear, and the hair cells that are performing sensory transduction of the sound vibrations in air into neural signals that are transmitted up the auditory nerve into the auditory brainstem, the cochlear nuclei, and the superior olivary nuclei. The auditory information is then sent up through the nucleus of the lateral lemniscus into the midbrain, the inferior colliculus, then on to the auditory thalamus, and on to the cortex. So the first and most obvious thing that you notice looking at this ascending auditory pathway is that there's a lot going on below the level of the cortex. And the way that most neuroscientists think about the processing that's going on at these different stages of the auditory pathway is that the brainstem nuclei appear to be doing something that's probably best described as cue detection. This is where there are nuclei of neurons that extract specific cues within a sound stimulus, such as the difference in sound loudness between the two ears, or onsets that occur across many sound frequencies and might be a cue, for example, for a consonant. So there's many groups of neurons within the brainstem that all seem to be extracting these different very low-level acoustical cues. At the level of the midbrain, the inferior colliculus, where all of this information from the brainstem then converges, the inferior colliculus would be better thought of as doing something akin to feature extraction. This is where neurons start to show responses to true properties of auditory objects, such as their location, combining cues like interaural level and interaural time differences into a representation of a property of an auditory object. So what does that leave for the cortex and the thalamus to do? Well, most people studying the cortex and thalamus would probably agree that our best guess on what the cortex and thalamus are doing is context analysis, putting the sound, that property of the sound, into the context of other experience, either short-term or long-term. But it's important to emphasize that the whole auditory system is involved in this contextual analysis, not least because this picture of the ascending auditory pathway is incorrect in a crucial aspect, which is it's not showing all of the descending pathways that affect auditory processing. So the auditory cortex receives extensive feedback from other cortical areas involved in decision making and cognition. And the auditory cortex sends extensive descending projections not only to the thalamus and to the midbrain, but down into the brainstem. And importantly, there are also projections from the superior olivary nuclei into the organ of Corti itself that thereby serve as an indirect route by which the cortex could effectively modulate the sensory transduction process itself. So by the very nature of the feedback, the ascending and descending inputs within the central auditory system, the whole auditory system really is involved in this contextual analysis. But it does, I'm going to show you evidence from multiple labs, including my own, that the cortex is probably key for driving that type of analysis. Okay, so let's start with just talking briefly about developmental context. I'm going to play you a bit of a piece called, the beginning of a piece called Different Trains by Steve Reich. So Steve Reich is another famous minimalist composer. He was actually a musician in the first performance of In C. And he became, I think, more famous than Reilly. So this piece in particular was inspired by sounds that Reich heard as a child on his frequent cross-country train trips. His parents separated when he was a baby, and one of his parents was living in LA in the US, and one of them was living in New York. So he spent a lot of time on trains between LA and New York as a child, listening to the sounds of the trains. It was also inspired by his realization as an adult that as a Jewish child in America in the 1940s, if he'd been living in Europe at that time as a Jewish child, he might have had a very different experience of being on a train. So the piece is also in later parts than the one I'm going to tell you about, is kind of a reflection on the Holocaust. But the thing I want to point out about this piece is that it was inspired by a childhood experience he had, and that shaped not only this piece, but arguably all of Reich's music, which is characterized by many repetitive musical motifs reminiscent of trains. All right, so I would argue that what's happened here is that arguably Steve Reich's brain was altered somewhat by the experience of having been repeatedly on these trains hearing these repetitive sounds. And that's now altered our experience of music, because that fascination with repetitive motifs has been reflected in his music that became very influential. Okay, so what's the neuroscientific basis for making that kind of claim? There's lots of evidence from many labs that developmental experience can shape the responses of neurons in the cortex. And this is just one example from the work of Xiaowen Bao. So this slide shows cortical maps for two rats. This is a map of sound frequency across the cortical surface. Each of these polygons, the color in it, is representing the preferred sound frequency of the neurons recorded at that location. And there are two maps shown here, one for an animal that was raised with continual exposure to 7.1 kilohertz beeping sounds, and another for an animal that was raised without any kind of abnormal exposure. And what you can see is that the region of the cortical map that is devoted to sounds at 7.1 kilohertz has expanded in the animal that was exposed to those sounds repeatedly during development. Moreover, these authors were able to show that this developmental exposure had a long-term impact on the animal, how the animal heard sounds. So what they did was, when the animals were adults, they trained them to do a frequency discrimination task where they listened to a train of tone pips, which then at some point started varying between two sound frequencies. It started off just one sound frequency, and then at some point became two sound frequencies. And the rats had to report when they heard the change. What the authors found was that if they looked at the behavioral performance of the animals as a function of sound frequency, compared to naive animals, these animals that had been exposed to a 7.1 kilohertz sound were actually worse at detecting changes from 7.1 kilohertz than normal animals, but better at detecting changes from other nearby frequencies. And the likely explanation for this is that a neuronal tuning curve is much more useful for determining differences between frequencies at its edges than it is at the top. Okay? But this is a beautiful piece of evidence that developmental experience not only alters cortical representations, but also alters hearing. And how might this work at a mechanistic level? This slide is taken from a paper by out of Rob Fromke's lab, also with Christoph Schreiner, in which the authors were recording intracellularly from neurons in the auditory cortex and analyzing the synaptic inputs to those cells during development, before and after patterned exposure to tone sequences. And this figure here is showing those conductances, the excitatory and inhibitory inputs to the cell they're recording as a function of sound frequency, and showing that before any kind of pattern stimulation, the tuning of the excitatory and inhibitory inputs was quite different. This is typical of developing animals. But after a pattern stimulation at around 2 or 3 kilohertz here, the tuning of the excitatory and inhibitory inputs to the cells started to become more correlated. And by the second pattern stimulation, the synaptic inputs, excitatory and inhibitory, appear to be very correlated in tuning. So the observation from this study is that synaptic modification, and in particular, alignment of tuning of excitatory and inhibitory inputs to cortical neurons, could be contributing to this phenomenon of development of sensitivity to developmental context, sensitivity to sounds that are heard during development. Okay, so let's now consider a slightly longer time scale of behavioral significance of sounds, behavioral experience with sounds. I'm going to play for you an excerpt from a piece by Philip Glass now called Two Pages. And this, I think, is a good example of how behavioral training or learning affects hearing and thinking about sounds. So this piece was originally titled Two Pages for Steve Reich because it was so strongly influenced by a particular piece that Steve Reich wrote called Piano Phase. But it was also strongly influenced by Philip Glass's experience as an adult learning about Indian music. And I'm going to read you a quotation here from a really excellent book that I highly recommend by Alex Ross about 20th century music, in which he mentions that after working with the sitarist Ravi Shankar, Glass began to think, as Indian improvisers do, in terms of recurring cycles of tones, of rhythmic pulses added and subtracted. Whoops. So I really love minimalist music, but it is something of a matter of taste. There's a story that in one of Philip Glass's concerts, a member of the audience at one point leaped up and yelled, "All right, I confess." So it is something of a matter of taste, but I really like it. Anyway, this is a very good illustration, I think, of how learning something about sounds in adulthood can influence the way you hear and the kinds of sounds that you want to hear. In Philip Glass's case, his experience with Indian music and his experience listening to Steve Reich directly influenced the kind of music he wanted to make and hear. Okay, so how might the neuroscience related to that phenomenon work of having behavioral training or learning influence what you hear? There's, again, decades of work on this topic, and you may have heard about some of it from Christoph Schreiner or from Christine. But this is an excerpt from a seminal paper from Shihab Sharma and Jonathan Fritz, where what the authors were doing was they were recording from neurons in the auditory cortex in an awake ferret that was listening to sounds. And what the ferret was trained to do was to listen out for particular sounds that were a cue that it needed to stop licking on a lick spout, a reward spout, or it would get a small shock. So it was listening to complex sounds and trying to hear out a particular sound. What you're seeing here is five different depictions of the response properties of a given neuron taken at different times in this task. And I first want to explain what this represents. So this is an STRF, or spectrotemporal receptive field. It's representing the stimulus sensitivities of the neuron. So there's frequency versus time relative to a spike of the neuron. And you can think of this as a snapshot of the stimulus that the neuron preferred to hear. So we can say, for example, based on this STRF, that the neuron was very responsive to sounds around 1 kilohertz. Now, what's interesting here is that when the animal was passively listening to complex sounds, the neuron had this kind of STRF, this kind of receptive field. But when the animal was engaged in a task that required him to listen out, he was trained to listen out for either 800 hertz or later here 400 hertz sounds, there were changes in the response properties of this cortical neuron reflecting that change in behavioral state. Even though the stimuli that went into making these maps of what the neurons responded to were exactly the same. And in particular, what was happening here is that the responsiveness of the neuron at the frequencies that the animal was listening out for as warning signals increased. Okay, you can see that for both sounds. So how might this kind of phenomenon work? Well, this has been a subject for a lot of recent research, but a brief summary of that research would say that a dominant factor seems to be disinhibition and inhibition in cortical circuits. There's a fundamental intracortical circuit consisting of pyramidal cells that are inhibited by parvalbumin positive or somatostatin positive interneurons. And both of these interneurons, it has been discovered, are inhibited themselves by another inhibitory interneuron, the VIP positive interneurons. And recent research has shown that feedback, particularly negative feedback, activates these VIP neurons, thereby inhibiting the other inhibitory interneurons, and that causes a disinhibition or activation of the pyramidal cells. So this is probably a key hypothesis, a key mechanism that may explain why, when an animal is learning to avoid a particular sound, the responses of cortical neurons increase their sensitivity to that particular sound. Okay, so now I'm going to go on to talking about acoustical context effects. And this is where I'm going to go into a little more depth as a case study, talking about some of the research that we've done in my lab. And to start us off, I'm going to bring you back to NC and talk about it acoustically for a minute. So from an acoustic point of view, what's happening in the piece NC is that you have this anchor of the regular pulse of the high C, which is preserved in an otherwise constantly changing soundscape. It's changing not only across the piece, but of course across repeated performances of the piece, since every performance is different. And you have these musical phrases, these 53 possible phrases that can reappear in different instruments at different times or in different combinations. So your percept of this anchoring C is going to depend, one of what I want to convince you about in the next bit of the talk, is that your percept of that sound, the anchoring C, is changing depending on what else is going on in the sound at the time, okay? And actually, I'm gonna play a little bit of the two sounds again. Maybe I'll just do it off, just very briefly, I just do it off of my computer if it's audible enough. Is that audible at all? Yeah. And then later, you really have to listen out hard for that high C. It's, you know. Okay. I'm going to leave that in the background for a minute and go on here. So I want to start off by talking about the whole problem of how we would even study acoustical context. When you think about it, it's actually a very hard problem to address experimentally. And that's because we don't have infinite recording time. If we're recording from a neuron in the auditory cortex and trying to figure out how the context in which a sound occurs influences it, we have a problem. We have several problems: that the recording time is limited, and the possible number of different acoustical contexts is huge. Okay, so we don't have infinite time to figure this out. That's a major constraint. And it's all complicated by the fact that cortical neurons, in particular, neurons throughout the auditory system, are nonlinear. They have nonlinear response functions, and this can limit our options or cause some problems with interpretation. And so I'm going to talk about this whole problem of how we even approach the question first. And we'll start with a cartoon. So let's imagine all we wanted to do was to figure out how a neuron responded to pairs of sounds presented at the same time. This is a pretty limited version of the question, how does a neuron respond to context? We're only going to ask, how does it respond to pairs of sounds presented simultaneously? So we might have stimulus dimension 1 and 2 being the frequencies of two simultaneously presented sounds. Now, the response function of the neuron to pairs of sounds probably is a hideously nonlinear function of these two sound frequencies. So the way in which people have tried to approach the problem of figuring out what the neuron does with those sounds, which means trying to estimate this response function, is with one of two approaches, which I'm going to call the narrow and deep approach or the broad and shallow approach. So the narrow and deep approach means that you constrain the stimulus space, for example, by fixing the frequency of one of the two tones and just varying the other. So you limit your recording time that way. And that, of course, gives you, as in this cartoon, a very good picture of what's going on for the little slice that you analyzed, but no idea what's going on with the rest of the response function. Now, the other approach, the broad and shallow approach, essentially involves, I mean, mathematically, fundamentally involves something akin to fitting a plane to this complex function, or some otherwise low-dimensional approximation. And so this approach clearly has the advantage that it gives you at least some idea of what's going on over a much wider range of possible stimulus combinations, but with the shortcoming that it's a pretty crude approximation to what might actually be going on. Okay, so I'm going to give you a few examples of how this has been done historically in both of the two approaches. So the narrow and deep approach is epitomized by what are called two-tone studies in the auditory system, a widely used approach throughout the auditory pathway. This is an example from work by Zhaoxing Wang in the marmoset auditory cortex, and they've done exactly what I was just describing. They're playing two tones, S1 and S2. They're fixing the frequency of one of them, S1, and that's what's shown up here in this top row, is rasters, spike rasters, showing the activity of the neuron to a tone or tone pairs presented here. This is the response to S1 alone. And then they're presenting S1 in combination with another sound with varying frequency, that's S2. So this is showing you what happens when S1 is presented with S2 and the frequency of S2 is varying. And then on the right here, what you see is the response of the change in the neuron's response to the combination of sounds relative to what the response was for S1 alone as a function of the frequency of S2. So this is basically a picture for the neuron of that slice through the cartoon response function. And you can see it's pretty much just as bumpy as that cartoon. So we weren't exaggerating, not exaggerating the problem. This is another classic example from a paper by Christoph Schreiner looking at combinations of sounds in time. So what the authors have done here is record from cortical neurons in the cat, and they first mapped out a frequency intensity receptive field for the neuron, frequency along the x-axis, intensity along the y-axis. The neuron has a typical V-shaped tuning curve. The responsiveness to sound frequencies, the range of sound frequencies that the neuron responds to broadens as the sounds get louder. What they've done is to choose one of those sounds that reliably evokes a response from the neuron and then play that sound preceded by another sound at various times. And they're changing the characteristics of the preceding masker sound while they look at the response to the probe. So if the delay between this masker, preceding masker and probe, is very long, then if they plot the response to the probe as a function of the intensity and frequency of the masker, they don't see any variation. Basically, it doesn't matter what's going on with the masker. The probe response is strong. But as the time delay between the probe and the masker gets shorter and shorter, the neuron's response to the probe, to the masker, begins to interfere with its sensitivity to the probe. And this is called forward suppression and has been studied widely throughout the auditory system. Okay, so that's the narrow and deep approach applied to the question of how acoustical context, the presence or absence of a masker, and the characteristics of a masker affect cortical responsiveness to a sound where we're looking across time. But again, this is a limited slice through the range of the neuron's possible responses. Okay, so the kind of epitome of the broad and shallow approach is STRF analysis, which was the process that was used to derive those pictures of cortical responses from the Schama and Fritz study that I described earlier. So the basic idea is that rather than restricting your attention to a few chosen stimuli, you use a very rich stimulus, such as this stimulus called a dynamic random chord stimulus. says frequency versus time. It's a spectrographic representation of the stimulus. Each of those boxes represents a tone pip, and the tone pips are randomly spaced in time and randomly distributed in frequency and intensity. So this sounds a little like this. Okay. Sounds a little like minimalist music, but minimalist music is more interesting. Okay. So the approach here is to record from a neuron and play a complex stimulus like this, and then record its responses and use and figure out as well as possible the relationship between the two. So here we have rasters and a post-stimulus time histogram describing the response of a cortical neuron to repeated presentations of this segment of the stimulus. And the most kind of straightforward way to apply this, what I'm calling the broad and shallow approach, would be to take each of the spikes recorded from the neuron, look back at a little window on the stimulus that preceded that spike, and then collect together all those windows on the stimulus and average them together. And in principle, this gives you a picture of the average stimulus that preceded a spike for this neuron. And so that's what technically the spike-triggered average is. But I'm showing something like it here, the STRF, where in this view, the lighter areas in this picture, which is frequency versus time relative to the spike, the lighter areas would represent higher than average sound power in the stimulus. The darker areas would represent lower than average sound power. And the kind of orange areas would represent sound power no different from the average. So the way to interpret this kind of picture would be that this neuron was responding, the average stimulus that preceded a spike for this neuron was lower than average, followed by higher than average sound power at about 16 kilohertz. In other words, a sound onset at about 16 kilohertz. But there's another way to derive these STRFs, which is much more powerful, and that is to view the STRF, or view this picture of the neuron's response function as a linear filter, which, when convolved with the stimulus, gives you the best possible, in some sense, prediction of the neuron's response. And if we view the process of estimating this receptive field for the neuron in that way, then the task of estimating it becomes a problem of linear regression. We're basically regressing the response against the stimulus. And we can apply various techniques from linear regression to improve the quality of the estimates that we get of the neurons' responses, where what I mean by improving their quality is that they allow us to do a better job of predicting the neurons' response to new examples of the stimuli. All right, so people use a wide variety of different sounds to do this kind of response function estimation, or STRF estimation, including sounds made up of frequency sweeps called ripples and a variety of different natural sounds. But there are a few issues that arise with using this approach, particularly with these more complicated stimuli, to try to understand how neurons are responding to sound context. And all of these issues arise from the fact that fundamentally what we're doing is fitting a linear or at least low dimensional model approximation to what may be a very nonlinear response function of the neuron. So the first of these limitations is the easiest to understand, which is that if you were to test try to obtain one of these estimates of what the neuron is doing using different stimuli, you will get different answers because you're testing different regions of the stimulus space. And if the neuron is nonlinear across that stimulus space, you will get different results just because the approximation is fit to a different part of the stimulus space, not because the neuron is necessarily adapting to to the change in the stimulus. The other complexities with this approach, or limitations of this approach, are a little less intuitive, but they also have to do with the limitations that are associated with fitting a nonlinear function locally and trying to interpret what that means. And to explain this more counterintuitive consequence, I'm going to tell you about what it means for a stimulus to be independently distributed. So the dynamic random chord stimulus that I played for you before is constructed such that if we know the stimulus power at one point in spectrotemporal space, if we know whether or not a particular tone is playing, that doesn't give us any information about what's going on in the rest of the stimulus. So that's the definition of being independently distributed. The DRC stimulus is independently distributed in spectrotemporal space. The ripple stimulus, which is constructed of frequency sweeps like this, does not have that property in spectrotemporal space. If you know the sound power at one point along a frequency sweep, then you know you can make predictions about what's going to be happening at other nearby frequencies or at future times because of the structure of the ripple. There is another space, the modulation transfer function space, which is defined by frequency sweeps and ripples, in which these stimuli are independently distributed, but it's not the spectrotemporal space. Okay, so what happens when we try to interpret a picture of what the neuron is doing, a receptive field, in a space in which the stimulus that we've used to estimate what the neuron is doing is not independently distributed? Well, that's illustrated here for a kind of toy neuron. If we imagine our neuron was sensitive to two different sound frequencies occurring at the same time, but it was sensitive in such a way that the neuron would only respond when both were present. Okay, if we were to estimate the responses, the response function of that neuron from its responses to a stimulus like the DRC that's independently distributed in spectrotemporal space, we would obtain an answer that tells us part of what we're after with trying to get a picture of the receptive field. It tells us correctly what tones the neuron is sensitive to. It doesn't tell us about the multiplicative interaction because the model is not capable of that, but it does at least give us a conservative estimate of what sounds the neuron is responsive to. And at least only in spectrotemporal space, if we were to drive the neuron with a ripple stimulus, we would get a different picture. There would be these sounds that we would judge the neuron as being sensitive to that are showing up in the receptive field in spectrotemporal space that actually the neuron, in this case, by construction, is not sensitive to. This is not true if we were to analyze the results in the modulation transfer function space. It's arising because in the spectrotemporal space, the ripple stimulus has higher order correlations that interact with the nonlinearity to show up in what we would like to be a more conservative estimate of the receptive field. So essentially, when there is sound power at these two different frequencies in a ripple stimulus, there also tends to be sound power at these neighboring frequencies. So that's the ripple structure showing through in a space, in a representation of the receptive field, in a space where the stimulus is not independently distributed. Now, with regard to the dynamic random chord stimulus and the ripple stimuli, these are widely used in the field, but this may seem a very esoteric technical point, but it becomes a very much more general consideration when you think about the problem of trying to understand how the brain is responding to natural sounds. Because unfortunately, natural sounds like vocalizations are not independently distributed in any space. So what this means is that if we try to estimate what a neuron is doing by looking at its responses to natural sounds, that's obviously a very useful thing to do in some settings, but it's not guaranteed to give you a conservative estimate of what sounds the neuron responds to, essentially, as shown in these examples, because higher order correlations in the stimulus itself can interact with nonlinearities in the neuron's response function to produce what are essentially artifactual regions of apparent sensitivity in the receptive field. Okay, so this is all by way of saying that there are some limitations to the broad and shallow approach that make it tricky to use in trying to analyze how acoustical context affects the responses of central auditory neurons. So what I'm going to tell you about now is some work that we've done recently trying to do what I would describe as deepening the broad and shallow approach. And specifically, what we've done is to try to develop a context-sensitive version of the kind of broad and shallow approach I described previously. So we have a stimulus in time and frequency. In all the data I'm going to tell you about today, we were using this dynamic random chord stimulus and recording from cortical and thalamic neurons in mice. So as before, we have a complex stimulus, like this dynamic random chord stimulus, and we're recording the responses of neurons to that stimulus and constructing a post-stimulus time histogram of the neuron's response. So the classic STRF, spectrotemporal receptive field, would be the set of weights, the set of weights that describe a linear filter, which when convolved with this stimulus, give us the best linear prediction of the cell's response. And so what we've done to try to extend this approach and make it more useful for studying the effect of acoustical context is to incorporate an additional stage, which is a context, a local context sensitive modulation of the effectiveness of each element in the stimulus at driving the neuron via its receptive field. So from now on, I'm going to refer to the STRF-like linear filter estimate of the neuron's receptive field as a principal receptive field, or PRF, and then the part of this model, or the part of our estimate of the neuron's response that is specifically devoted to analyzing the impact of acoustical context, I'm going to call the CGF, or contextual gain field, because essentially the role that this is playing in the model is to modulate the gain with which the neuron responds to each element in the sound as a function of what's going on around that sound element. Okay, so I'm going to come back to this in a little bit, but to start with, I want to mention that, so if we use this model to predict responses now, what we're doing is first determining how the effectiveness of every sound element in the complex stimulus would be modulated by its context, what the impact of local context is, and then we're convolving that modulated version of the stimulus with the PRF, this linear filter, to get the neuron's predicted response. And we can get better predictions of the neuron's responses in both cortex and thalamus using this model than one can with the STRF model. So this is a plot of generalization or predictive performance on new versions of the stimuli for the CGF model versus the STRF model. So for nearly every neuron that we've tested, the CGF model performs better than the STRF model, indicating that the acoustical context is important and useful. It's also the case that this model helps us predict neural responses better than other models that have a similar structure and similar dimensionality. So we think this means that that acoustical context is actually significantly shaping the responses of cortical and thalamic neurons to sounds, to complex sounds. And what does this shaping look like from moment to moment in a complex stimulus? What I'm showing you here is this dynamic random chord stimulus, a spectrogram of it along the top again. And then for four different neurons, they're CGFs, these contextual gain fields estimated from the neuron's responses to this sound. And then the convolution between that CGF for each neuron and the sound. So this essentially provides a kind of neuron-specific saliency map. This is showing what elements in the sound were particularly salient or particularly effective at driving the neuron because of the context in which they appeared. That would be the red areas. And the blue areas would be sounds that were less effective because of their acoustical context, sounds for which the context in which they appeared suppressed the neuron's ability to respond to them. So what you can see here is that there's very rapid fluctuations, even for the same tone frequency along one line here in this plot. There's very rapid fluctuations between that tone being less or more effective at driving the neuron, depending on what else is going on in the sound at the time. And in general, we find that these acoustical context effects on the gain of cortical and thalamic neuron responses are quite large. So this plot is showing the median input gain effect and the variation in it across the stimulus. So essentially how much variation between blue and red was there in these neuron-specific saliency maps across a whole stimulus, and what was the median amount of gain change. And what we observe is that the range of modulation is very large, so these IQRs are quite broad. But on average, the dominant effect of acoustic context is suppressive. And this is consistent with some previous work. Not exclusively suppressive. Sometimes it's facilitatory, but in most cases it's suppressive. Okay, so coming back to this model, I want to talk now about what these contextual gain fields have told us about how neurons in the cortex and thalamus respond to the context in which a sound occurs within a complex stimulus. So this is examples of four contextual gain fields and associated principal receptive field for neurons, four neurons in the cortex and four neurons in the thalamus. So these PRFs down here are similar. They can be interpreted similarly to an STRF. The yellow areas are representing excitatory subregions of the receptive field, and the blue areas representing inhibitory subregions. The CGFs should be interpreted differently. So here, blue regions are representing a suppressive effect of sounds on the sensitivity of the neuron to a target sound here at the notch. And the red areas are representing enhancing effects. And I'm going to say more about that on the next slide. But for the purposes of this slide, what I want to point out is that there's a lot of cell-to-cell variability in the structure of these CGFs, but there seem to also be some consistent features. And those consistent features are easier to see in averages. So this is an average across cortical cells, an average CGF across thalamic cells. And what you can see is that for a given target sound, and let's imagine that this is the high C in Terry Riley's piece in C. Okay, so what we're looking at is how other sounds that are occurring simultaneously with or before that high, a particular playing of that high C sound, how those other sounds might be affecting the way the brain is responding to that high, to that C. And so what we find very reliably, and not too surprisingly, is that is that sounds that are similar in frequency to the target sound that occur before it in time tend to have a suppressive effect that decrease the gain of the neuron's response to this target sound. And sounds that occur simultaneously with the target sound, more surprisingly, sounds that occur simultaneously with the target sound, but about half an octave higher or lower in frequency, seem to have an enhancing effect. And we can see differences not only between neurons in the characteristics of this delayed suppression and simultaneous enhancement. We can see differences also between cortex and thalamus. So for example, the time course of this delayed suppression effect is shorter in thalamus than in cortex, which is consistent with what we would have expected from the two-tone studies using simple stimuli. And we also find if we look at a slice through these CGFs, average CGFs, at time equals zero, we can see this enhancing effect of simultaneous sounds about half an octave above or below the target sound. Okay, so this phenomenon of the narrowband delayed suppression is very reminiscent of forward suppression that's been studied with two tones, with tone pairs. But here we've been able to estimate the characteristics of that forward suppression from the neuron's response to a complex sound. The other phenomenon of the broadband simultaneous enhancement is more surprising, and has there's been hints of it in previous studies using only two tones, but not so consistently. And we think that this that both of these phenomena might relate to perceptual experiences. There's a well-known perceptual phenomena of forward masking, where it's harder to hear a sound if it's preceded by another instance of that or a similar sound. There's also a perceptual phenomenon of sensitivity to simultaneous onsets, that sounds that co-occur are particularly salient perceptually. That's a set that essentially seems to be what we're seeing traces of at a neuronal level here. We've also used this approach to look at different areas of the central auditory system, comparing, first of all, two different subdivisions of the auditory thalamus, the ventral and medial subdivision. We didn't find any differences in contextual sensitivity between these two subdivisions, which was somewhat surprising given that the medial subdivision is thought to be more involved in plasticity. It doesn't seem to differ from the ventral subdivision in this sensitivity to acoustical context, although it might to developmental and behavioral context. In the auditory cortex, however, looking at two different auditory areas, we did find clear differences in the sensitivity to acoustical context of the neurons. This is comparing primary auditory cortex A1 with the anterior auditory field AAF. And what we found was that in the temporal dimension, the time course of this delayed suppression, narrowband delayed suppression, was longer in A1 than in AAF. And the magnitude of this simultaneous enhancement was stronger in A1 than in AAF. So the fact that there are differences in sensitivity to acoustical context in two cortical areas means that it's very likely that that intracortical circuits or projections from subcortical areas to the cortex are involved in shaping the sensitivity to acoustical context. Okay, so to conclude, what I've tried to show you in this talk is that cortical and thalamic receptive fields are nonlinearly modulated by local acoustic context, and that we can estimate the nature of this modulation from neuronal responses to complex sounds. I've also shown you that the gain of neuronal responses to each stimulus element in a complex sound depends on the immediate local acoustic context in which that sound appears. And this kind of input-specific gain modulation, where the sensitivity of a neuron to an element in a complex sound is dependent on what is going on around that sound, seems to have a very significant influence on both cortical and thalamic responses to complex sounds. We see differences between individual neurons and also differences between two cortical areas. And in general, there are two key features to this sensitivity. One is this narrowband delayed suppression, and the other is an apparent enhancement of sensitivity to simultaneously occurring sounds at different frequencies. So we think that this amounts to an example of single neuron sensitivities to acoustical contacts that essentially mirror perceptual phenomena such as forward masking and sensitivity to common onsets. So to bring us back to the beginning, the main point here then is that cortical, particularly cortical, but arguably cortical and thalamic, receptive fields are not fixed entities, even at the shortest timescales, even when the global stimulus statistics and the behavioral state and the developmental experience of an animal are held constant. There's fluctuations in what the neuron is responding to that are a function of context, even at very short timescales. And I just want to acknowledge the people who collaborated with me on this work. So this work was done in collaboration with Manish Sahani at UCL and involved several people in the lab, Misha Aronson and Ross, more recently Ross Williamson, who were PhD students in the lab, Bjorn Christensen, who was a postdoc, and more recently the work's been continued by Arne Meyer, who's a postdoc in the labs. Thank you.